I don't think that believing in God, the God of Christianity, will actually complete God's purpose. Christianity is not about believing. It's about doing, and about doing things differently from the way we would have done them otherwise. And I say this with a heavy heart. I really do think that the church has so often missed the point. We love getting lost in our arguments about the Trinity. Well, is God really Father, Son, and Holy Spirit? Well, I don't care. The image is maybe helpful to get our minds around the complexity of God, but God is expressed in lots of different ways. By the way, I think it's generally assumed with the patriarchal Eurocentric model that the real God is God the Father. You know that, don't you? And then there's Jesus, who's sort of the PR side of God, and then there's this Spirit thing that we're not really sure about, and it's sort of feminine anyway, so that makes it suspect. So, I don't want to trivialize, but I do think piety around belief has done incredible damage to the gospel. Getting our beliefs right is not what it's all about. The cross of Jesus, as we have it in the center of our worship space, is a symbol of God's pain and suffering. Some believe Jesus is God, and we can get into all of that, and you get all these complicated things about is God bleeding on the cross? I don't know. And or is God the Father requiring Jesus to suffer this terrible torture and punishment and death so that God feels better? I don't know. I don't want to get into those arguments. All I know is that God's true heartache is about the state of the human condition and the insensitivity of God's people, the moral bankruptcy, the cruelty of people to each other. That's where God's pain really is. So I would invite you to be a little less literal in the story of the cross, and rather use it to remind yourself that God longs to enter into our struggles and understand us deep within. God goes straight to stage 5 and wants to know exactly what's going on inside you. So the issue is not developing a mature understanding of God, but rather allowing God to understand us, attuning our souls and hearts to the ways of God so that God can be alive in us and work in us. This means, by the way, that as God is alive in us, that we then enter into the pain and the suffering of others, and we're available to listen and to hear the struggles and sense the pain from the inside and become an advocate. We empathize deeply and almost have a visceral need to understand how it feels from the other person's point of view. Please always remember that you were made in the image of God. And not just the physical image. You not only look like God, but God made you in God's image spiritually. God created you to be godly. The celebrated United Methodist theologian, Dr. John Cobb, has been a role model for me in how to live and reflect on the Christian life. He's a brilliant man. And a wonderful Christian. He writes this. He says, "I find God in the natural processes of my body. When these are not thwarted and impeded by external circumstances, I find God in my feelings when these are open and spontaneous. I find God in my reason when this is drawn by truth rather than by the effort to justify myself. I find God in my imagination when this is free and creative. I find God in my will when it aims at justice and righteousness. I find God in my spirit when it orients the whole of my life toward that which is worth achieving and frees me from petty, self-serving concerns." Amen. The primary goal of the Christian life is to allow the godliness that God has planted within us to direct our paths and to infuse our relationships. The purpose of prayer is not to use God to fulfill our wishes, who was it referred to it as a divine genie, you rub the lamp as you pray and get your wishes fulfilled, but rather prayer is about disciplining ourselves in godliness and allowing the God energy, the God compassion to work in us and through us. And this will always draw us towards those who are in pain, those who are suffering, those who are experiencing violence and fear and hate. We do this in personal physical contact, and we do this through the exercise of active imagination we call prayer. Prayer is a mechanism of empathy and compassion. If Christians and Christian churches are not spending time directly and indirectly with war, the victims of violence, poverty, and the victims of oppression and marginalization, we have missed the whole point of the cross and the suffering, compassionate God of Israel. Yeah, I want to close with a Kay Cooper story. I don't want to idealize her into something perfect, which she wasn't. And she would be the first to tell you that. But 3 weeks ago, was it 3 weeks? Three Sundays ago that she was here? Two Sundays? Three Sundays ago. In the midst of all her chemo and her treatments, and she had the hat on because she didn't want people getting upset that she'd lost her hair, you know. In the midst of pain and nausea and cancer treatment, Kay came to church. She had made a very deliberate decision not to allow cancer to dominate her life. She was outside the front of the sanctuary here before the 9:30 service, welcoming people. With a big smile on her face, she gave a warm greeting. And more often than not, she was engaging everybody who came in conversation. I don't know how many of you remember her doing that with you on that day. She was genuinely interested in hearing what was going on. Right up to the end, her focus was engaging other people at their point of need. Right up to the last day she could, she was working in the food pantry, she was sleeping overnight with Family Promise, she was teaching Sunday school, she was visiting sick people. And we know that her track record of supporting people in need and responding was just incredible. You see, Kay gave expression to the suffering God and made God real in the world. And hundreds, maybe thousands, were touched by her ministry that in many ways came out of her own pain. That's the way God works. Thanks be to God for Kay, but more than that, thanks be to God for the promise of the presence of the suffering God in all of our lives, so that the world through us may be healed, racism, sexism eradicated, oppression and hate be banished. It can be done in the power of the God of love. Praise be that ours is a suffering God who understands and enters into every struggle with us. Amen.